Too, but God's love's gonna see us through. she tie. Every round goes higher and higher. Keep your eyes on the prize. Hold on. Hold on. Hold on.
Good afternoon and welcome to the State University of New York College at Old Westbury as we celebrate our 50th year of existence. Born out of the civil rights and human rights movement, we still stand strong for the equality of all and for social justice, not only here at our college, across Long Island, across the metropolitan region, but certainly in the United States of America and across the world. For us, all lives matter, and we continue to strive for peace and freedom, justice and equality. Today, we welcome to our college United States Representative, the distinguished gentleman, John Lewis, called by Roll Call magazine a genuine American hero and often referred to as the conscience of the United States Congress. U.S. Representative John Lewis was a founder and became chairman of the historic Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee and played a central role in the fight for civil rights throughout the 1960s and beyond. His impact on American society has earned him numerous awards, including the highest civilian honor granted in the United States, the Medal of Freedom, which was presented by President Barack Obama, the Lincoln Medal from the historic Ford's Theater, the Martin Luther King Jr. Nonviolent Peace Prize, the NAACP Spingarn Medal, and the only John F. Kennedy Profile and Courage Award for lifetime achievement ever granted by the John F. Kennedy Library Foundation. Congressman Lewis is also the co-author of the number one New York Times best-selling graphic novel, March, written with Andrew Aden and illustrated by Nate Powell. March served as the common reading assignment for all members of the fall 2015 entering class of the first year students at SUNY Old Westbury. Welcome, Congressman John Lewis. Mr. Bill Moyers. Mr. Bill Moyers has been recognized as one of the unique voices of our times. His career in broadcast journalism has spanned over four decades and earned him more than 35 Emmy Awards, 9 Peabody Awards, 2 Alfred I. DuPont Columbia University Awards, the National Humanities Medal from the National Endowment for the Humanities, the Penn USA Courageous Advocacy Award, the Lifetime Achievement Award from the National Academy of Television Arts and Sciences, and the Honorary Doctor of Fine Arts from the American Film Institute. Prior to his journalism career, he worked in the administration of U.S. President Lyndon Johnson and played a pivotal role in the development and passage of the Civil Rights Act of 1964 and the Voting Rights Act of 1965. Distinguished journalists, welcome Mr. Bill Moyers. And our moderator, Mr. Les Payne. Mr. Les Payne is a Pulitzer Prize-winning journalist who has experienced a nearly 50-year career covering domestic and international affairs, most frequently for Newsday. His assignments have included the assassination of Martin Luther King Jr., the 1976 Soweto Uprising, and the rise and fall of the Symbionese Liberation Army. He is also a founder and former president of the National Association of Black Journalists. Mr. Payne has worked to improve media, fairness, and employment practices, not only on Long Island, but across America and across the world. Welcome, Mr. Les Payne.
Good afternoon. The future of America, race and class. This is indeed a heady topic, and we have two distinguished guests, as introduced, to grapple with the issue on the occasion of the 50th anniversary of Old Westbury University College. I've been asked to moderate, so I'll be the third person in the ring. I'll try to keep the clinches fewer. The 50th anniversary of the college coincides with historical landmarks in the evolution of human and civil rights in this country. On March 7, 1965, an incident erupted when peaceful participants in a voting rights march from Selma to Montgomery were met by Alabama state troopers who attacked them with nightclubs, tear gas, and whips. As a peaceful marchers fled and pled for their lives, some were severely beaten, none more than John Lewis, who is with us here on that bloody Sunday, which was given to us toward this generation in the recent movie Selma. A week later, on March 15th, President Lyndon Baines Johnson spoke to a joint session of Congress, and among other things, he outlined the devious ways in which election officials down south denied African Americans the vote. And of course, on August 6, 1965, President Johnson signed into law the Voting Rights Act. Bill Moyers was a press secretary during this period of the President of the United States, Lyndon Baines Johnson. So both of our guests are not mere witnesses to unfolding of this significant act of American history, but they are key participants. Mr. Moyers is used to interviewing the historical figures. I'm gonna take that role today, and we're gonna deal with him as someone who participated in the unfolding of a very significant part of history. You've heard the background and bio of Mr. Lewis. On that day, March 7th, 1965, you've seen the movie. Some of you, you certainly have seen the historical photograph. Since we have you here, walk us up to that moment where you're standing facing those troopers. What did you anticipate?
First, let me just say that I'm delighted, very happy, and very pleased to be here. And I want to thank President Butts and this college community for inviting me to be here to participate. I feel more than lucky, but very blessed and honored to be here. On March 7, 1965, we were walking to dramatize to the nation and to the world that people wanted to register to vote. In Selma, Alabama, in 1965, only 2.1% of blacks of voting age were registered to vote. The only place you could even attempt to register was at the county courthouse. You could only attempt on the first and third Mondays of each month. You had to pass a so-called literacy test. People had been asked to count the number of bubbles in a bar of soap, the number of jelly beans in a jar. People stood in an unmovable line. There was lawyers, college professors, high school principals, teachers, farmers, who were told over and over again that they couldn't pass the so-called literacy test. I remember going to Selma in 1963 for the first time, 23 years old, had all of my hair and a few pounds lighter. and going back there over and over again as part of the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee. And on January the 18th, and it was my day to lead a group of people to the courthouse, January the 18th, 1965, the sheriff, a man by the name of Jim Clark, was a very large man, tall. He wore a gun on one side, a nightstick on the other side, and he carried an electric cap router in his hand, and he didn't use it on cows. He met us at the top of the steps at the courthouse. And he said, John Lewis, you're an outside agitator. You're the lowest form of humanity. And I said, Sheriff, I may be an agitator, but I'm not an outsider. I grew up only 90 miles from here, and we're going to stay here until these people are allowed to register to vote. He said, you're under arrest. And he arrested me along with about 60 other people. And a few days later, Dr. King and others came to Selma, and Martin Luther King Jr., several ministers were arrested, 300 school teachers were arrested and went to jail. And a few days later, Bill Moyers would tell you, and I'm so honored to be here with him and to be with you. A young man by the name of Jimmy Lee Jackson, involved in a nonviolent protest. He was beaten. He tried to protect his mother. He was shot in the stomach. And a few days later, he died at a local hospital in Selma. And because of what happened to him, we made a decision to march from Selma to Montgomery. And on Bloody Sunday, about 600 of us left a little church, the Brown Chapel AME Church. We started walking in twos. We came to the highest point on the Edmund Pettus Bridge. I must go back for a moment. On that day, I was 25 years old. I was wearing a backpack before it became fashionable to wear backpacks. And in this backpack, I had two books. I thought we were going to be arrested, that we were going to go to jail. I wanted to have something to read. I had one apple and one orange. I wanted to have something to eat. Now, one apple and one orange wouldn't last that long. To be in jail with my friends and my colleagues, I wanted to be able to brush my teeth, a toothpaste and toothbrush. Mm-hmm. We get to the highest point on the Edmund Pettus Bridge, crossing the Alabama River. We saw a sea of blue down below, Alabama state troopers. We continued to walk. We came within hearing distance of the state troopers. A young guy by the name of Jose Williams from Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. staff said to me, John, they're going to gas us. We walked and kept walking. A major spoke up and said, this is an unlawful march. It would not be allowed to continue. I give you 3 minutes to disperse and return to your homes or to your church. And Jose said again, Major, give us a moment to kneel and pray. And the troopers put on their gas masks and they came toward us, beating us with nightsticks and tramping us with horses and releasing the tear gas. I was hit in the head by a state trooper with a nightstick. My legs went from under. I fell. I thought I was going to die on that bridge. I thought it was my last nonviolent protest. 50 years later, I don't know how I made it back across the bridge to the little church, but I do recall being back at the church. And later, apparently, a group literally carried me to the Good Samaritan Hospital in downtown Selma, where a group of nuns took care of us. Mm-hmm. But because of what happened, President Lyndon Johnson made one of the most meaningful, one of the most powerful speeches any American president has made in modern time on the whole question of voting rights or civil rights. Mm-hmm. And he closed that speech that evening by saying, and we shall overcome. I was sitting in a room in a family home with Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. and a few others. When President Johnson said, and we shall overcome, I looked at Dr. King. Tears came down his face, and we all cried a little. And Dr. King said, we'll make it from Selma to Montgomery, and the Voting Rights Act will be passed.
Mm-hmm. Now, you were the chairman of the SNCC, Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee, which was tended to be the younger Turks, as it were, to the Southern Christian Leadership Conference, which was Dr. King's group. And Dr. King was not in the group that particular Sunday, yes?
Dr. King was back in Atlanta preaching the morning sermon at Ebenezer Baptist Church that he co-pastored with his father. Reverend Abernathy was back in Atlanta, and they sort of suggested that we should maybe hold off. And Andy Young, Ambassador Young, said to Dr. King in a telephone call, the people are here, they're ready to march. He said, well, maybe they should go and march, and I will be in the next day.
Okay. Now, 1,000 miles away in Washington, D.C., obviously President Johnson, who's aware of the turmoil that is mounting down there, although he didn't know the outcome, none of us did. Mr. Moyers, you were his press secretary. In terms of Dr. King in touch with the White House and President Johnson in any way leading up to March 7th?
Yes. I hadn't quite become press secretary. That would happen in the summer. At this time, from the assassination until this time, I was President Johnson's special assistant for domestic affairs and had worked on, as you said, as Calvin Butt said, the Civil Rights Act of 64 and the Voting Rights Act of 65. And we were, the President, the White House, we were monitoring what was happening in Selma at the time of the march and leading up to it, because there was considerable pressure on the President from civil rights activists and moral people around the country to pass a Voting Rights Act. And the President wanted to do that, but he was a master of timing. He'd been in the Congress for some 36 years, and he understood that there were times to enact legislation and times you couldn't. And he was waiting for the right moment. This he did not think was the moment, because we had just several months before passed the Civil Rights Act of 64, and the President thought Congress was exhausted with that long and difficult process, and it would tax them too heavily and probably could lead to defeat if we went too soon to Congress with the Voting Rights Act. So we were following these events. Different ones of us were talking regularly to members of the group that were in Selma with John Lewis and with Martin Luther King, and not expecting what happened there. I was at home that Sunday afternoon. The White House Operations Center was staying in constant touch with our contacts in Alabama, and the Justice Department was too, when the radio began to broadcast news of the violence that was developing and in fact was about to happen. So the President called me back down to the White House. I got there just in time to hear one of the radio broadcasts, and they announced that we couldn't see it. There was no live television at that time, no smartphones either. So we were relying on old-fashioned telephones and radio reports. And about late in the afternoon, they announced that CBS would carry footage of the events that day. So in the Oval Office, with the President and several of us, we watched the event in which John Lewis, then 25 years old, point man on the march, was hit and struck, knocked down and feared dead by the announcer on the TV. That's the first time we saw the actual event. I remember the President later said, what was that young man's name who was seriously injured? And somebody said, John Lewis, and the President muttered to himself, and for all practical purposes, don't let him die. None of us had anything to do with your surviving, Dr. John, but we were all praying that that would not happen. The President that very evening turned to me and said, get Dick Goodwin started on that speech. It was the speech that John Lewis referred to. The President, 3 days later, I think it was, gave that speech to Congress and uttered, he actually took the words of the civil rights movement and made them the national mandate, let us overcome. We shall overcome, let us overcome. It was one of those moments when an unpremeditated courage on the part of all those young people and John Lewis changed history by giving the President of the United States the opportunity he had been hoping for to take advantage of a moment when we could do what was historic and pass the Voting Rights Act. I'll tell you just a footnote to both the Civil Rights Act of 1964, after it had passed, tough slog for months trying to persuade the Congress to do this. And when it passed, I said to the President, Mr. President, you look very melancholy. I'd gone over to see him in the mansion of the House on the other side of the Oval Office. He had the Bulldog edition of the New York Times, of the Washington Post, which said, President signs historic act. But the President looked depressed, quite frankly, melancholy at least. I said, Mr. President, you should be celebrating. This is a great day. And he said, I think we just delivered the South to the Republican Party for my lifetime and yours. He was right, of course. After the Voting Rights Act passed, I said to him, I asked him, do you think this will lead to a black president in our time? Remember, this is 65, the year of the march, the year O. Westbury was founded. It was a long time ago, as things go. And I said, do you think we'll have a black president? Does the Voting Rights Act mean in our time we'll elect a black president? He said, no, we'll have a woman first. And I was wondering, wherever he is, what he was thinking in 2008 when Barack Obama beat Hillary Clinton for the election. But never underestimate the power of your witness as young people. And never forget that it takes courage on the ground, as in Ferguson and Baltimore and Missouri. It takes courage on the ground to move others to act. And then it takes leadership in politics to enable that courage to be vindicated, for that courage to be exemplified, and for that courage to lead to real change. Those two go together. And in these very difficult times, where we are coping with new issues, old issues that are in new incarnations of race and class, it's going to take both courage on the ground and courage in high places to move this nation out of its deadlock, out of its paralysis, out of its laissez-faire attitude toward social justice, and move us forward again, as John Lewis and Lyndon Johnson and a lot of other brave young men in civil rights and members of Congress enacted with that legislation.
Now that you've brought up Hillary Clinton.
Did I bring up Hillary Clinton?
Missing her term. No. And I know it's a political year, and this is not a political discussion, but I must ask at this point. The director of the movie Selma was criticized for downplaying the role of Dr. King. I'm sorry, of President Johnson. And Hillary Clinton was criticized some time back, and others have said that the role of Martin Luther King, you know, was far overshadowed by the action of the president signing the bill. Which one got it right? Let's talk about that a little bit. What was the interrelationship between Dr. King in terms of him, his group, and the movement exerting pressure on the president? How did that start? First, Mr. Lewis, what do you think? Was it talked about, we want to influence the president to do this, that, and the other thing? Was that the whole point, or was that a major point of the movement?
I think part of the movement from its inception was to make it plain, Dr. King's father, that we call Daddy King, would sometimes be in the pulpit while young Martin Luther King Jr. would be preaching. And Daddy King would say, make it plain, son, make it plain. He was saying, in effect, make it real, dramatize it. Mm-hmm. Martin Luther King Jr. had the ability, the capacity, to make it real, to make it plain, so the whole nation, the whole world can see it. Mm-hmm. You know, we didn't wake up one day, the young people, and said we're going to sit in at a lunch counter. Mm-hmm. We didn't wake up one day and said we're going to go on a freedom ride, or we're going to march. We prepared ourselves. We went through nonviolent training. How could people sit on a lunch counter stool or get on a bus and ride through the South in an interracial fashion? Let someone beat you, put a lighted cigarette out in your hair, pour hot water, hot mm-hmm. coffee, chocolate, and mm-hmm. still engage in the way of peace, mm-hmm. the way of love, the way of nonviolence. We had to make it real. Mm-hmm. We had to make it plain. Mm-hmm. And we thought and we felt that if we be true to this immutable principle and philosophy of nonviolence, the nation would respond, mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. and politicians would respond. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. That's the flow of history, which of course involves individuals. And I want to focus just for a second, Bill, on President Johnson. Now, you worked on his campaign as a volunteer, as I remember, in 1959 when he ran for president. Is that right?
Well, I had worked for him in the summer of 1954 on his correspondence staff when I was 20 years old in Washington. Right. And then in 1960, he hired me to work with him on his campaign for the presidency. Mm-hmm. I was the liaison between the Kennedy camp and the Johnson camp. And then at the time of the assassination, I wound up at the White House because I was then mm-hmm. deputy director of the Peace Corps. So I'd worked with him off and on for 9 years.
Right. Now, if, again, this is speculation, but if Lyndon Baines Johnson had become elected president in 1960 instead of Kennedy, do you think that he would have responded the way history unfolded? Just in terms of the personality, if you get me.
He was a very cautious politician with this sense of timing I was talking about, and I can't say that in 1960,
of course,
when the country was still fairly divided on this issue, that he would have seized the opportunity that he would have created the opportunity. But if the opportunity presented himself, he would have acted. Lyndon Johnson was no champion of civil rights mm-hmm. for most of his career in Congress. He was a New Deal congressman from Central Texas under Franklin Roosevelt and more liberal. But when he became senator from all of Texas, which is a very conservative state, his silhouette identified with the silhouette of Texas, conservative, pro-business, pro-corporation, and he ran in 1948 for the Senate against Harry Truman, President Truman, who was running for president mm-hmm. on a very affirmative action civil rights program. He was very cautious. He was the Senate Majority Leader when the first civil rights since the Civil War was passed in 1956. I was working with him then. He compromised it considerably, weakened it greatly, diluted it immensely. He passed the Civil Rights Bill in the Senate, in the Congress in 1960. It was diluted, it was compromised. But interestingly enough, in 1963 at Gettysburg, of all places, as Vice President, he made one of the most powerful and most arresting civil rights speeches in American history. Look it up. 1963, Gettysburg, Vice President Johnson makes a speech that anticipates what is coming. It's a powerful speech. And when he was pressing the civil rights bill at great risk to his personal standing in 1964, a reporter named James Deacon from the St. Louis Post-Dispatch at a press conference in the East Room of the White House raised his hand. Jim Deacon was a tough bulldog of a journalist. And he said, "Mr. President, I want to ask you, you've never been known to be a champion of civil rights. Why are you putting everything on the line now to pass this Civil Rights Act?" And I was standing at the back of the room and holding my breath because I wasn't sure exactly how President Johnson was going to act. And in a slow, almost inaudible voice, he said, "Well, Jim, I'll tell you, all of us make mistakes when we're young. Few of us get a chance when we're old to correct those mistakes. I did, and I am." So he had this politician sense that when you have the chance to do the right thing, you take it because you may not have that chance again. And he knew that the destiny of the nation rode in this moment on what these young people, these black people, these college students and young ministers and everyday citizens in the South were doing, standing up, getting killed. You know, at that time it was against the law in Birmingham, Alabama, to play checkers with a white man if you were black, or a black man if you were white. You cannot imagine today the suffocation of the apartheid system in this country in the 1950s and the 1960s. And at this time, he knew that the right stand could in fact be one of those hinges of history in which the whole thing turns. And he did it because he knew it was the right thing. Even when he was in politics and denying civil rights, he knew it was the wrong way to go then. And when he had the chance to do the right thing, he did. How lucky, how fortunate, how coincidental. He was an accidental president. Mm-hmm. Catapulted into the White House when John F. Kennedy was killed, shot in Dallas. He was an accidental president who took advantage of the accident to make an historic turn in America's social policy.
Did President Kennedy have any effect on him in that whole sweep of history at all?
Well, President Kennedy had become a pro-activist for the civil rights movement, but he had put together a very good bill. The bill we passed mm-hmm. in 1964 was largely John F. Kennedy's bill, mm-hmm. and it had all the right provisions in it. But Kennedy was, as a Catholic in a Protestant nation at that time, as a Massachusetts New Englander, he was hamstrung in trying to get that bill passed. And he made a fundamental mistake in not sending the bill up when the moment was right. Johnson took advantage of the sentiment that was attached to John F. Kennedy's assassination when the country, hundreds of thousands of people said they voted for Kennedy after he was assassinated, who had voted for Nixon in 1960. Yeah. That's the way it went. But Johnson knew the mood of the country was right. Mm-hmm. The night of the assassination, I flew back with him from Dallas on Air Force One. And we went not to the Oval Office, because out of a sense of propriety, he was not going to go to the Oval Office where the rocking chair of John F. Kennedy still stood. We went over to the Vice President's office in the Executive Office Building across the small street separating the White House from the Executive Office Building. And we worked 3 hours. He called a lot of members of Congress, called a small staff together, called a number of leaders around the country, called the civil rights leaders at that time, Whitney Young and Rory Wilkins and people like that. And about 10:30, I said, "Mr. President," and I automatically started calling him Mr. President at that time. I said, "We've got to go out to your house and have some dinner." So I started gathering up his materials and putting them in his briefcase, and he had paused as we started down that long office, and he was looking at the far wall. And I said, "Mr. President, we need to go." And he said, "You see that bulletin board down there?" I turned, there was no bulletin board. There was a painting, some flowers. I said, "Mr. President, we need to go." And he said, "No, wait a minute, look at that handwriting on that bulletin board," just the two of us in the office. There wasn't a bulletin board and there was no handwriting. He said, "Every president who's ever been in that office," he pointed across the street to the Oval Office, "comes into office with writing on the blackboard from every one of his predecessors. So I've got to figure out what John F. Kennedy left on that blackboard, and we've got to get action on that." And that night, in his bedroom at the Elms, which was the vice president's home, there were four of us with him sitting on the bed as he said, "We're going to pass Kennedy's civil rights bill." And he took that agenda from John F. Kennedy, exploited it as only a successful and, I think, principled politician of the moment could do, that opportunity mm-hmm. to move the country forward. Mm-hmm.
Good point. Now, we have a lot of young people here, and Mr. Lewis, you were young. You started young. You went to Fisk soon after you joined the movement back then. And so what was, at the age 23, you spoke at the March on Washington. What was that like? What someone of your age with that experience and that, did you have a sense of the moment?
If I could go back for just a moment.
Please.
See, I grew up in rural Alabama,
mm-hmm.
50 miles from Montgomery.
Right.
I heard about Rosa Parks.
Right.
I heard the words of Martin Luther King Jr. Mm-hmm. on old radio. The action of Rosa Parks, the words and leadership of Dr. King inspired me. I didn't like segregation. I didn't like racial discrimination. I saw the signs as a little child. When we would go downtown to the theater, all of us little black children had to go upstairs to the balcony, and all of the little white children went downstairs to the first floor. Mm-hmm. I kept asking my mother and my father, my grandparents, why, why? They would say, "That's the way it is. Don't get in the way, don't get in trouble." Mm-hmm. But the action of Rosa Parks, the words and leadership of Dr. King inspired me to find a way to get in the way. I got in the way. I got in trouble when I went off to college. Mm-hmm. We studied what Dr. Kane was all about in Montgomery. And we studied the way of peace. We went to a nonviolent workshop. Every Tuesday night at 6:30 p.m., mm-hmm. we would go to a little church. Mm-hmm. And we studied what Gandhi attempted to do in South Africa, what he accomplished in India. Mm-hmm. We studied Thoreau and civil disobedience. And we followed the drama of what was happening in Little Rock in 1957 with the nine African-American children, young people trying to enter Central High. So we were ready. And by, I got arrested the first time on February 27, 1960. Mm-hmm. And I grew up being told by my parents, don't get in trouble. And they thought going to jail would be bad for the family name. Mm-hmm. But when I got arrested the first time for sitting in at a Woolworth store, waiting to be served, with 89 other college students, I felt free. Mm-hmm. I felt liberated. I felt like I crossed over. Mm-hmm. So during the 60s, I was arrested 40 times. And since I've been in Congress, 5 more times. And I'm probably going to get arrested again for something.
Can I Les has to defer to me because when I was publisher of Newsday, I hired him, gave him his first job.
Yeah, that's right.
And I still haven't signed that last check we owed him. But, I had a mentor once who said to me that principle is how you act when no one is watching. And there's a story about John Lewis that maybe some of you have heard. I know it because, and by the way, if you want to see the very best conversation interview that John Lewis ever did, go to BillMoyers.com.
There you go.
And up on the right-hand corner in that little white box, just type in John Lewis.
There you go.
On the anniversary of the March on Washington, where both of us were, I was just as an onlooker. He was a mover and shaker. I interviewed him on the 50th anniversary of that, so look that up. But something happened that day behind the scenes the press knew nothing about that showed what character really is and how courage plays out when nobody is looking. Would you tell that story simply of that speech that you were told not to deliver?
Well, I had, with the help of my colleagues in the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee, had prepared a speech. And some people thought it was a little too radical, maybe a little extreme.
It was.
And in the beginning
what,
of the...
Tell our audience, if you recall, what in the speech upset them?
Well, we don't have time, Les, to tell the whole story. But one part of the speech in the very beginning, the original text said, in good conscience, we cannot support the administration proposed civil rights bill.
Right.
That it was too little and it was too late. Mm-hmm. There was not anything in the bill
that'll
to protect old women and young children involved in peaceful, nonviolent protests. And we talked about, while I was working on the speech, I saw a group of black women in Southern Africa carrying signs saying, one man, one vote. So in my March on Washington proposed speech, I said, one man, one vote is the African cry. It is ours too. It must be ours. Mm-hmm. And then it went on down and here and there. I said, you tell us to wait. You tell us to be patient. We cannot wait. We cannot be patient. We want our freedom and we want it now. That was. But then, I won't call the person name, but one person said to me, the leadership. He said, John, you can't say we cannot wait. I think you've been facetious, maybe a little cynical. So you can't say we cannot wait, cannot be patient. He said, you know, the Catholic Church believe in being patient. So I knew he was just playing with me. So, but then near the end of the speech, Bill, I said something like, if we do not see meaningful progress here today, we may be forced to march through the South the way Sherman did nonviolently. Dr. King said to me, John, that doesn't sound like you. And A. Philip Randolph said something like, John, we come this far together. Can we stay together? Called the Archbishop of the Diocese of Washington, Bishop O'Ball had threatened not to give the invocation if I didn't change the speech. But my friend and a wonderful young man by the name of Julian Bond, who was a communication person, gave out copies of both speeches. So the press got the original text and the speech that I actually delivered.
If I may add a footnote, you know, that's the only role we journalists play, is to add footnotes to the what the actors of society, the makers of history do. You're in the lower rear of the Lincoln Memorial in Washington. There's Lincoln on the other side of this stone wall. You're with the big six leaders of the civil rights movement. You're 25 years old. Nobody's really heard of you who's anybody. And these six, who are honorable men, negotiating with the White House and Congress to get a civil rights bill passed, these elders of the movement, the tribal leaders, let's say, they were saying to this firebrawl, you can't say this, you'll upset the White House. You'll upset the Democratic president of the United States. And particularly, they didn't say this, but they meant the Catholics who worked for him. I knew Kenny O'Donnell and Richard McGuire very close. Particularly that use of the word patience in a Catholic concept really did upset the Archbishop of Washington, who called the White House to complain about this guy. But anyway, here he is. There's no reporter taking anything down. There's no camera recording this act it wasn't defiance. It was out of respect that he told the truth. Out of respect, he told his elders the truth, which is the great mission of young people today. And he stood up to them. They thought he was radical, not because he was a leftist, but because his views would upset the Democratic establishment as incarnated in the White House. Told them to do the right thing. He did the right thing, and that made all of the difference.
In 1965, there were 6 African Americans in the House of Representatives and 0 in the U.S. Senate. And now, fast forward, you know the numbers. You're in the Congressional Black Caucus, and there are at least 2 in the Senate. And the President of the United States is an African American. So in terms of the impact of the Voting Rights Bill, quite apart from those political numbers, what impact has it had?
Well, the election of, well, now we have 46 African American in the House, 2 in the Senate. African-American president, as you stated. It says something about America. It says something about the distance we've come, the progress we've made. And members on the House side sit on every major committee. Some are ranking members. If we were in the majority, some would be chair of the full committee. I think we have impact in Washington. But it's not just Washington. Look around the nation. In 1965, 50 years ago, the state of Mississippi had a black voting age population of more than 450,000, and only about 16,000 were registered to vote. Today, the state of Mississippi has the highest number of black elected officials than any state. Have an African-American member of Congress. But it's happened to change the attitude. We're not there yet. We're not there yet. But I tell you, I am very hopeful, very optimistic about the future. We will get there. And there will not be any turning back. People may interrupt the flow of history. But as a people and as a nation, I am convinced that we will get there and transform our country into a better place and move closer to what Dr. King called the beloved community. We will come to that point, but we will lay down the burden of race. We will do it. And if we can get it right here in America, and I think we will get it right, we will serve as a model for the rest of the world. And you can see African-American members of Congress, white members, Latino members, Asian-American members, working and pulling together. As A. Philip Randolph said from time to time, we all in the same boat. And it doesn't matter whether we're black or white or Latino or Asian American, Native American. We're one people, we're one family. We all live in the same house, American house, or beyond American house, the world house. I'm convinced that we would get there.
Before John, we pitch it forward.
John is more hopeful, excuse me.
Yeah,
John,
sure, no,
John is, you said have a conversation. You're more hopeful than I am. And I'm glad you are. I guess if I had been snatched from the jaws of death, I would practice hope every day too. Yeah. I would. But, you know, 80% of Congress today is white. 80% of Congress today is male. And 92% of Congress today is Christian. We have changed the complexion of Congress, but we have not changed the structure of Congress that can represent the will of an empowered minority, men, women, and Christians, the majority, at the expense of a disempowered minority. And we have to, that has to change. Furthermore, John, I'd like to hear you on this. I came late. You know, I grew up in a small town in East Texas, half black, half white. I never heard the word slavery from elementary school through my senior year. We had been the capital of Missouri during the Civil War because after the Federals drove the rebels out of Missouri, the government in exile came to Marshall. We were for 5 weeks the military capital of the Confederacy. After Richmond fell, the military government, seat of government, was moved to Marshall, Texas, my hometown. And it was, I grew up well-loved, well-churched, and well-taught without knowing anything about the lived experience of the other 10,000 people in town who lived just a 6 blocks from where I grew up. This great veil, denial, I think continues to exist today despite the presence and power of Westbury. This veil is there. And the reason I'm not optimistic at the moment, I said to a friend of mine on Wall Street recently, how do you feel about the market? And he said, well, I'm worried. And I said, why do you look? And he said, I'm optimistic. And I said, well, why then do you look so worried? And he said, because I'm not sure my optimism is justified. I'm not sure my optimism is justified because white supremacy is not part of our DNA. It is our DNA. We have been in denial all of these years about the fact that the government of the United States fought for and by architects who believed in freedom and liberty, nonetheless had embraced slavery and arranged the government. Two-thirds, you were two-thirds of a person in those days, John, and yeah. Two-thirds of a person so that the Southern segregationists, the white supremacists in the South, would continue to have power in Congress. White supremacy is the way we've organized our society. We snatched back the opportunities afforded former slaves in 1876 with the end of Reconstruction. We looked like this country was shaped the way Nazi Germany was shaped and the way apartheid South Africa was shaped. And that white supremacy is deep within the institutions, the structures, and the ethos of people who, like me growing up in Marshall, Texas, didn't know we were advocates of white supremacy. Lyndon Johnson and I used to kid each other that we were both beneficiaries of affirmative action for poor white Southern boys. But when you advocate today for affirmative action for poor white black kids, you get a reaction that we didn't get then. The reaction in Ferguson, the reaction in Baltimore, the reaction all over the country is reinforcing the notion that our society was, white supremacy was baked into the foundation of this country, and they're not going to give up easily. And you get this whole reaction embodied, and by the way, I was a Democrat, and I know the Democratic Party is flawed, but the Republican Party masks their bigotry in all this talk about limited government. And don't forget for a moment about the fools they're making of themselves in those debates. And remember that they've still got the Electoral College, they've still got 30-some-odd legislatures, and they're unrepentant about making sure this wave of equality and justice get no further than the others did. That's why I am not as
optimistic. Bill, let me agree with you on this major point. And I truly believe that racism is a disease. It is deeply embedded in the very psyche. It is embedded, deeply embedded in American society. And my hope is with the very, very young, the young people, students,
right.
Black, white, Latino, Asian American, and Native American. You know, I spoke about revolution at the March on Washington. I wanted to speak about revolution. Now, we have somebody running for president now on the Democratic side talking about revolution, but I spoke about it a little more than 50 years ago. There must be a revolution of values, a revolution of ideas. And we have to get people to move to that point. The state of Texas, your native state, most of the South, and it's not just the South, places like Pennsylvania, Arizona, and others, trying to make it harder, more difficult to carry out the mandate of the Voting Rights Act of 1965.
Exactly.
Look, in my book, there's no such thing as an illegal human being. Why don't we set 11 or 12 million people on a path to citizenship? Why don't we have comprehensive immigration reform? It's the politics. The Republican Party recognized the fact that when Texas become again a Democratic state, they can kiss it goodbye. Kiss it goodbye. Because people get out, they become legal, they register, they vote. It's a new day. And America will be transformed. I am convinced beyond a shadow of a doubt, you're gonna see more African American, more Latinos, Asian American coming into power and changing America forever.
This first discussion, they have to go into politics like you did, because we have to change the structures which will dismantle the racism that you rightly say is deeply imbued in our system. And that means gerrymandering, that means getting money out of politics, that means getting rid of a Supreme Court that is undermining voting rights.
But in the process, we can never give up. We can never lose hope. Because when you lose hope, it's like giving up.
I defer to him.
This discussion will go on. This discussion will go on, but I'm told by my betters, not right now. We'd like to thank Bill Moyers and, of course, John Lewis for the discussion.
Brighter days will soon
Did you enjoy Bill Moyers and John Lewis? Pardon me for being backstage, but Mr. Moyers and Mr. Lewis have to, Mr. Lewis has to catch a train to get back, so he's going to be on his way and will not have the opportunity to interact anymore with us. Mr. Moyers also has to get back. But I want you all to know how much I appreciate your being present, helping us to celebrate 50 years of the State University College at Old Westbury, born out of the civil and human rights movement, dedicated to social justice. And I also want everyone to spread the word that the excellent education that one receives here at the State University College at Old Westbury prepares you for a cosmopolitan world in which we live. We are the most diverse student body in the system, the SUNY system. And that diversity, that diversity is one that we believe in and one that we advocate for. I want to thank our faculty who are here, one of the best faculty in this entire system. And I appreciate your help and support, especially with not penalizing the students for being a little late today. So thank you all very much. God bless you, all the best, and we look forward to seeing you at more celebrations. Thanks to all the community members who are here from all the various institutions. Appreciate you. Appreciate you. Appreciate you.